quick disclosure. We're terribly sorry for the first few slides to be smudged. There was construction and there was dripping water on our way here. And on transparencies, that's what happens. So, wonderful. Good morning, judges, esteemed judges, and also distinguished guests. Thank you for being with us today. I would like you to take a moment to think about the last time that you forgot your keys at home. Or maybe in Hong Kong, you forgot your octopus card at home. You had a great day planned ahead of you. But by the time you were about to embark on your journey, you realized you forgot a simple thing that's preventing you from reaching your goals. Hello, my name is Jason. I'm here with my colleagues, Rebecca, Michelle, and Yuji, and we form K4 Consulting. Today, we want to make sure that Tencent is able to return and make sure that they remember the simple thing that makes them great, so that they are able to propel themselves into the future. So with this, we're going to take a quick look at a comparison between Facebook and Tencent, as you have asked us to do. Today, the question we're answering is, what can Tencent do to win globally? We want to look through Tencent's lens, because other teams may be comparing the two companies. However, this could prove to be a bit of a challenge, as there's no action plan for either one. So today we'll be comparing their revenue streams, as well as also their user profile. Who are they targeting, each one of these companies? Altogether, today our recommendation is to integrate WeChat messaging with Tencent's dominance in the gaming industry. And so without further ado, and with a clear slide, we are going to dive right in. So looking at the revenue stream, and if Michelle focus, fantastic. Want to stay focused. So Facebook has approximately 97% of their revenues coming from advertising. This is a large portion of their revenues, with only 3% of their revenues coming from gaming. However, Tencent is quite the opposite, where gaming represents 71% of their current revenue. And advertising, although started off as zero, is now growing to a staggering 24% of their revenue. And so we're seeing dominance in both areas in terms of Tencent. And so our key takeaways from this is that Tencent's revenue is focused on gaming, while Facebook's advantage is really still in advertising. And so what does this really mean for Tencent and Facebook? Let's take a quick look at their acquisitions and how each company plays in the fintech industry. So with Facebook, they have acquired WhatsApp. Although this was a strategic acquisition, they're not making any money through this acquisition. And they also acquired Masquerade, which is enhancing the user experience of their other product lines. However, on Tencent's side, we're seeing that Tencent is aggressively acquiring overseas startups for a geographic purpose rather than a strategic purpose. And other gaming giants are their prime targets. Recently, they acquired Supercell and also Riot Games, two of the largest game manufacturers in the world, as well as also a lot of non-software companies. And so we're seeing a bit of a discrepancy in the types of businesses that each of these companies want to involve themselves in. In terms of mobile payments, we see that PayPal is a partner of Facebook's, while WeChat Pay is actually a proprietary method of payment that Tencent is wanting to build itself in. In terms of mobile wallet and credit scoring, neither firm has done a good job of this. And this is primarily due to regulation and also issues with privacy. And so our key takeaways here is that we want to see, we see Facebook's acquisitions are more so strategic. And so they want to better the experience of their users through their current, through acquisitions. And so they want to find complementary businesses to better their current experience. However, Tencent is really focusing on geographical acquisitions and focusing on increasing their dominance globally. And so with this, we want to talk about, and just a quick note, this is why we will be focusing on the cost aspect of our recommendation today later on in terms of our decision criteria. So let's talk quickly about the privacy and innovation side of each of these companies, as you've asked us to do. First of all, Facebook is de-anonymizing their content. And so what this means is that they'd like to capture more client content, and they'd like to take this and sell it to first and third party users. Albeit, I was very surprised by this because I use Facebook. However, Facebook actually tracks you whether or not you use their platforms or not. At the same time, Tencent has very favorable privacy laws in China in their favor, where they get to experiment with profiling and they get to experiment with data collection. in terms of innovation, we see that Facebook likes to buy companies rather than innovate. They have reached the stage where Facebook is already a mature technology, but they like to buy companies to help them expand their portfolio. While Tencent are masters of imitation. They like to copy, they like to make whatever their competitors are doing, take that and make it even better. We can see that Tencent has an obvious advantage in terms of their development cycle, as they have a 2.5 month development cycle compared to other competitors such as Facebook, who have an average of 6 months for their development cycle. And so with this, Tencent can clearly beat up their competitors if they choose to innovate. And this is really focusing on the time aspect that we'll be talking about in a very short while. So let's quickly talk about our exciting proposition in terms of gaming and in terms of VR. So gaming-wise, Facebook, as you know, does not have a very strong foothold in gaming. However, Tencent owns the top 10 games out of 30 in China. That brings in approximately $13 billion in revenue a year and another $11.1 billion in yearly growth. This is why this industry is exciting for us. And lastly, they actually own $1.3 billion of market in terms of gaming outside of China, which will help them expand globally. And so in terms of VR, this is really more so future-focused. However, the market is looking to grow to $120 billion by 2020. And so gaming really is Tencent's strength, and it really is a platform for Tencent to expand globally. So with this, we want to talk about why we are going for gaming, and also in terms of our user profile, why it really fits with our recommendation.
Thank you, Jason. So after our revenue stream analysis comparison, we are moving on to user profile comparison. So in terms of user base, Facebook is operating in all of the countries except China, Iran, and North Korea. Sorry for the typo. And we have 1.7 billion users. And in terms of WeChat, we have 0.9 billion users. And 90% of them are in China, and 10% are sitting elsewhere. So this is a political attitude matrix. So in terms of WeChat, Facebook, China, and North America. So starting from the first box in WeChat in North America, because in North America, we do not have infrastructures that support WeChat's pay function as well as food delivery or taxi. So that's why WeChat functions are partially, or most of them are restricted, especially for the other functions. And it's also not welcome to the market because as we all, we're in Canada, and then we all use WeChat. However, the reason why we are not using WeChat very frequently in Canada is because all our friends are not using WeChat. So then we can't really chat with friends on WeChat. That's why it's not very welcome to the market because it's not widespread. And the second box, however, WeChat in China is very, very good because the Chinese government is fully supportive of what WeChat is doing in China. And also, they're investing a lot into R&D as well as VR. In terms of Facebook in North America. North America is a very regulated environment, as Jason mentioned, and Facebook is able to collect a lot of data from all the users, and also Facebook is widely used in North America. And as for the last box, because China is very sensitive about censorship, that's why it's not very welcoming Facebook into China, because they have to censor whether people will post things that Chinese government do not want to see on Facebook. That's why there's a very strong barrier to entry in terms of government regulations and Chinese preferences. Of Facebook in China. So here's our customer preferences. So meet Xiaoming and Jamie. So Xiaoming is a typical Chinese boy in China. So what they want are basically the same. So basically Xiaoming, he wants to play games using WeChat, and then he also wants to connect with not only his friends, but then also the players to play the same game as him. And also he's also looking for convenience. So whether this is for food or transportation, such as getting a taxi. So what he gets from WeChat or Tencent is he gets Tencent games as well as connection with friends on WeChat through chatting, and then also a platform that connects every single thing such as TV chatting or ordering food online. However, in Facebook, so Jamie is a typical boy who lives in BC. So basically he wants the same thing, which is connection with friends, games, sharing moments in life, as well as convenience. However, what he gets in terms of chatting, he gets Messenger to talk to friends, and then also there are Facebook posts or Instagram posts that people share about life. However, Facebook is very advertisement heavy, which normal users do not want to see because it makes the whole platform very messy. And also that Facebook is unable to link every aspect of life in one platform. That's why we feel like comparing Tencent to Facebook is mainly about experience comparing to product. So as Jason mentioned, that we are focusing on the cost, feasibility, and time. So here are the alternatives that we thought about during our brainstorming process. So we, in terms of alternatives, we have Africa. We are focused on WeChat Game and Game Chat. For Africa, what we are thinking is that because currently China is engaging in developing infrastructure in Africa, which is called One Path, One Road. And in terms of the cost, we think that we can develop a WeChat in Africa. However, the cost will be very high. So as you can see, breaking 1 to 5, 1 is very costly, very time consuming, and not feasible at all. So in developing infrastructure in Africa is very expensive. That's why we give it a 1. And then also it takes a very long time for Africans to adapt to this new lifestyle. That's why it's very time consuming. And in terms of feasibility, because personally I've been to Kenya before, and locally they have this M-Pesa, which they use it to do micro payment transferring. That's why they think that WeChat Pay will not work perfectly there, because they have a minimum transferring amount. That's why it's not very feasible, so I give it a 2. And for VR focus, we are thinking of developing games together with all the VR headsets using Tencent technology. But we don't think it's very costly, it's time consuming. However, it's also not very feasible, because currently there are a lot of competitors, like Jason mentioned, such as Google, Microsoft. They're also having their own VR headsets, so it's not very feasible. And for the V game and game chat, which Rebecca will elaborate more into details later, so basically what WeChat and game chat is being like is about combining chat functions as well as game functions in WeChat to penetrate more market into other parts of the world. So it's very cheap, because basically we only have promotion costs and partnership costs. However, time is very fast to implement, because it doesn't require new technology to be developed. And it's also very feasible, because currently especially for North American users, game players, they do not have a proper chat room to chat about their experiences, and also they do not use WeChat. So we think it's very feasible to give them a new idea of how we can combine chat and games. So now we move on to Rebecca to talk more about our last alternative, WeChat and Game Chat, which achieves a score of 13.
Thank you so much, Michelle. So we are so excited to present to you WeGame and Game Chat. And this is a Tencent's new strategy for global expansion as well as penetration into a market that Tencent is very strong in, which is game, and combining it with an area that WeChat or Tencent is not as strong in, which is chat rooms. So we think that this goal of combining extensive gamer base with the chat base will allow introduction, adoption, and retention of new players and new users into the Tencent world to create a more market penetration as well as more user base. So we are excited to introduce you to the first part of our strategy, which is WeGame. Now, WeGame is all about bringing WeChat and Tencent physically into the gamer world. And how we're going to achieve that is through 3 steps. So first, we're going to platform partnerships. So who with Xiaoming and Jamie, who buys their games from Steam or physical stores in North America or anywhere else in the world, they can go into a store or go online and see the games as well as purchase them with whatever PayPal credit cards. However, we want WeChat to have a presence there. So for Steam, we want WeChat to maybe have a little logo or a web page attached to the games that Tencent already owns. And that way we can push out promotions, for example, like discounts, if you sign up for WeChat. So if you have a WeChat account and you buy this game, you will automatically get a 5% discount. And Jamie will be very happy about that, because he is a money-saving student. Secondly, we want to have WeChat stands as well as physical promotion posters in physical stores. For example, join WeChat, join a chat room, and we will give you a discount code to buy, for example, the physical games that Tencent owns. And this way, we will not only be able to incentivize players to join WeChat, but we can also educate them about kind of the opportunities that WeChat has for them, which is extended to pay, extended to gaming, extended to cab calling, a lot of opportunities. Secondly, once they join WeChat, we will definitely combine that gaming experience with their chat experiences. We'll push out more promotions, we'll push out gaming opportunities as well as advertisements, and we'll make sure that WeChat is an immersive gaming platform for them to chat with their friends as well as receive advertisement and information about the games that they're passionate about. And thirdly, we want to translate that into further on. So after they buy the games and after they play the games, we want to hear feedback from them, as well as allow them to join a loyalty program where the more they buy, for example, like skins in League or mods in different games or as money in Clash of Clans, the more that they buy, the more that they win. So they're able to collect points, get gifts that normal players are not able to get, only and exclusively through QQ, Tencent, and WeChat. And now the second part of our recommendation is game chat. So Jamie comes home on a Friday night. He's exhausted from midterm, but he's gonna play League, and he knows it. So he plays for a couple of hours, and he decides, okay, I'm gonna rest for now, but I want to plan a weekend game with my buddies. How does he do that? Well, my friends usually plan through Facebook, and they get on, they plan a little Facebook group and chat, but not all of their friends on Facebook play League, and not all of their friends on League have Facebook. So how do we fix that problem? We believe that Tencent can really penetrate that market by forming a partnership with the games that they already have, since they already own a lot of those platforms, and then incentivize users who play those games to join WeChat. And how we do that is, firstly, we open official chat rooms by Tencent Games. So official chat rooms by League of Legends, official chat rooms by Clash of Clans, and we're gonna modernize them and make them unique to the location as well as the games that they want to play. For example, we can open 500 chat rooms just in the Vancouver area where Jamie is. We can make them specific to the location, for example, like Gastown, and we can have 50 members in each chat room so that they're small enough for open communication and big enough so that there's interaction. And then after the chat rooms are open, we want the members of the chat rooms to use WeChat and open WeChat and chat with their friends. So plan your Saturday League game or plan your Clash of Clans next strategy. And all of this can be achieved on the WeChat chat rooms. And these can consist of strangers or friends that you already have. And we will even further incentivize that by saying, if you pull in 5 or more friends, you will get more Clash of Clans cash, or you can get more mods or skins for League of Legends. After that, to incentivize them to stay and really really stay with WeChat and Tencent, we want to give them bonuses. So we suggest a daily draw for the games, such as skins, mods, cash, etc., within each individual chat room so that the players can stay excited and fresh about the games and want to stay in the chat rooms. So we want to take you through what Jamie is going to do when this promotion plan is played out. So when he's playing League of Legends, there's going to be a little bubble on the side that says, Jamie, sign up for WeChat. We will give you some mods, we'll give you some skins, and then Jamie's going to go into the chat room called Level Up Gastown. There's 50 members, and he's going to stay in it because every day there might be a potential to win a skin or draw and cash. So this is how we're going to implement it. First, we're going to partner with the platforms, and we believe that this will take up to 6 months. So this is just about communication and negotiation. We're going to push out the promo plan, which is going to be half a year, and then we're going to have the online platform, which is going to be pushed out right away, and the physical storefront platforms pushed out a half a year later with planning, printing, etc. And then the loyalty program can be pushed out instantaneously along with the online platforms. Game chat, the chat room research. So where should we build the game chat rooms? How many should we build, and to what specific characteristics should we tailor these chat rooms to? We introduce it, and then there's a buy-in continuously. For the big bonus, we want to have annual or like big holiday bonuses we push out in every chat room every year.
So what impact will this actually have? First of all, those actually allow us to be able to build the infrastructure we'll need to really expand on, for example, VR research, as well as building infrastructure for payment systems as we expand into North America and the rest of the world. In terms of more specific ideas, the immediate effect that we can see that will happen is a relatively conservative estimate we put together. Okay, so here previously WeChat had about 900 million users, and now we're going to be pushing it to almost the rest of the world. So we estimate potentially we'll have 20% new registrants after 1 year, and that will bring us much closer to the current Facebook users of 1.7 billion. Afterwards, potentially say 10% of those users actually start to retain with WeChat and use it a lot more frequently, which will bring us revenue streams of about a 10% increase and approximately a 20 billion RMB revenue increase. Again, this is a very conservative estimate based on our time. So in terms of qualitatively, first of all, we'll be able to have loyalty. Second of all, we'll be able to have a focus from China to the rest of the world through gaming, which is a huge and continuously increasing market. And last but not least, as I previously mentioned, we'll have an infrastructure to expand. Some risks and mitigations, lack of buy-in, we can deal with through either partnerships as well as adjusting our current targets. So basically today, we came to the problem of how does WeChat expand using Tencent to the rest of the world market and compete with Facebook, where there can be potential language barriers or lack of user retention, by using and penetrating through the gaming experience and the huge gaming market, as well as the VR side, we'll be able to not only penetrate but also maintain and build infrastructure for our future. Thank you very much for your time. We're now open to the floor for any questions.
Thank you for the presentation, and you have developed a very good product for Tencent. WeGame and GameCheck. Yeah, and then you should sell the royalty to Tencent. But I want to ask that why you do only the product development or the recommendation for Tencent, but not much for the Facebook. Is it you think that there's no hope for them and that is
That's a wonderful question. And so when looking at the case really just asked us to compare the two companies and to see what advantages and disadvantages each one had. And so actually we wanted to take that one step further than just to compare and contrast. We wanted to give one of the companies the lucky chance to have a strategy moving forward. And so really why we chose Tencent is because we're in Asia, but also because it is a new challenge for us. We are very accustomed to Facebook. We know that Facebook are already looking at certain developments, and even in the case, they have a 5 and 10 year plan for Facebook, however WeChat did not have that. And so what we really wanted to do is give WeChat and Tencent the opportunity to have a way of developing their current pipeline, refocusing on what they're the best at, and take that to the next level moving forward, whereas Facebook really has a lot of that already.
If I make a statement, the success of Tencent, you know, they are so concentrated in China that like the large part of their work is because of the support of the Chinese government. Mm-hmm. Do you agree or not?
Yeah. So we definitely strongly agree with that, and that's in fact why we made the matrix on the political census on the two different countries, for example, comparing China to North America. As you traditionally know, Chinese government has always been very protective of its local companies, whether it be, for example, Didi, even though Uber came first, as well as for WeChat. Obviously, then the problem going forward for WeChat and Tencent to expand to the rest of the world is really, will the other governments be equally supportive? Especially in North America, for instance, there was a very specific remark about our new president, Trump, who may not be very China-friendly. Then that is why exactly we decided to take this gaming approach for what Tencent can do to really penetrate that market. Because first of all, right now, Tencent doesn't have the infrastructure needed to set up payments, to set up apps, so on and so forth. And obviously the other big problem is that they don't even have the user base in the first place that will, for example, retain and continue using the service because, for example, Facebook has a lot of users and that's why everyone's on there. So by taking the gaming perspective, gaming market is huge, and for example, even just League of Legends alone, it's huge in North America, Canada, USA, I play it, he plays it. And by going through there and incentivizing users from the gaming space to start using this app for even small gifts and bonuses such as power-ups for our characters, we'll be able to really start small and eventually scale big as time moves on. Because right now, obviously, we want Tencent to be able to grow quite fast. But in order to be able to go fast, first of all, you have to have users, and second of all, you have to have infrastructure. But you can't convince people to even build infrastructure if you don't have the users. So we're going to start with the users from the gamers and offer things such as if you bring in a new member, you'll get even more discounts or even more costumes for your characters, and use that to continuously build up and eventually compete with Facebook by specializing on gaming, which is what Tencent is good at, whereas Facebook is more on the social network aspect.
In that case, do you think your projection that you made about the revenue and the cost involved is realistic? Yes, I'm interested.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. So, just a bit of an honest talk here. First and foremost, because we have a lot of information on exhibits, for example, user growth, revenue streams growth, etc., and so on and so forth. But because we took the unconventional approach of penetrating from the gaming market, we actually didn't have too much information to go on from the case there. So what we really did here is make some rough assumptions about the changes we expect to happen. First and foremost, I'm going to address it from two prospects, the cost side and the revenue side. Costs, we are already acquired like 25% stake in Activision, the entirety of Riot, and almost the entirety of Clash of Clans as well. So in order to really, you know, set up a DLC content, what you basically do if you already own the company is kind of say to the team, hey, can you make this new content, like a new costume for like my village? And then the skin will be implemented just like that. And because it's already integrated with Tencent's operations, I expect the cost for such things to actually be quite minimal. Of course, there will be, for example, the discounts and potential margin decreases that will happen from there. But because our ultimate goal here is really to penetrate the market, not to just increase revenues, we consider that to be more of a negligible item and didn't have too much focus on costs. Now, in terms of the revenues, this is just a revenue projection based on the user base increase we're expecting. So really a rough estimate of how many people actually game in like North America. We're looking at about, you know, say 400 million people or so, and then maybe 25% of the market actually games. So then we're looking at, say, about 100 million people that do game. Then we actually implement this for the really popular games, like 80% of people actually do play. Maybe nowadays we're looking at more of a 60-75%, so let's say we have 75 million players that do play. And even if we just push out one item there, if you're a long-time player, you know that you will jump on the ship to grab that costume. So even if they just sign up once to get that code, if we continue really pushing for the items there, we expect that they will actually be retaining, for example, about 10%. There will be weekly, daily, and even monthly bonuses and promotions. So unfortunately, I do agree that these projections are not the most accurate out there, but I do believe it is a conservative enough estimate of what the impacts it can expect to be.
So I'm a little confused out here. Mm-hmm. When you started playing Clash of Clans, did you know Tencent owned it? You don't start playing a game because, or the company that owns it,
yes.
Play a game because it's a popular game and this thing. So the
yes.
company that owns it doesn't matter,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yes, exactly.
Okay. So the reason I'm asking the question is,
mm-hmm.
I do not understand your revenue model here, okay? You want to grow, you want to move the gamers to a WeChat
mm-hmm.
or platform. How do you want the company to monetize that? So let's say
mm-hmm.
outside China, you grow another few hundred million users on WeChat. I do not see how you're going to monetize it. You will have them, and I can see the strategy around that. I cannot see a strategy of monetizing those users in terms of generating a revenue stream.
Absolutely.
Because the gaming is not going to be based on, because just Tencent owns it, okay? You're going to buy a new game or you're going to move to a new game based on what your friends play, what you've heard about it, whether it's a popular game, it's a good game.
Take that much. Thank you so
sure.
much for your question. So I believe that I believe that WeChat does not gain their revenues from advertising. They actually gain their revenue, start to set, from the services that they provide, for example, like WeChat Pay. And I think that once we establish a chat room with extensive user base and a lot of these people who do play games, there will be an interaction, for example, with Red Packet, which is a very traditional Chinese tradition of sending money to friends and family and for holidays. But as of late, we've been seeing a trend of sending red packets for example, I owe you money for lunch, or I lost a bet and I have to pay for that. Or, for example, I want to gift you a skin, but I can't necessarily gift you a skin on WeChat. Sorry, skin is a clothing on League of Legends. I can't really give you a clothing on WeChat, but I can give you some pocket money, or I can give you some birthday money. And we believe that once you establish this gamer base on chat rooms on WeChat, and they start to kind of feed into actually buying the services, for example, like WeChat Wallet or WeChat Red Packet, they will actually put their money into WeChat, and that is a revenue source for.
What are the regulations around mobile wallets and stuff like that? Have you given any consideration to that?
Absolutely, so I can touch on that. In terms of regulations, in terms of gaming even in North America, this would not infringe on any of that. A lot of the other companies that own other games, they already have mobile wallets and can transfer real money to other people. And another way that we're looking at revenue is really not at this stage. We're not looking at a micro stage. In terms of Tencent penetrating into the North American market, right now they don't have a stronghold, they don't have infrastructure, nor a brand. And so the best way to start generating exorbitant revenue is by first gaining the trust and also building relationship with potential customers. WeChat has a fantastic monetization model with their other ecosystems, whether it be the WeChat Pay, whether it be ordering food online, whether it be all of their convenience offerings. And so with that, the North American market could really use something like Tencent and WeChat's offerings in North America. However, they just don't know about it right now. And so the best way to do that is to first have an interaction, a live interaction with Tencent and WeChat's offerings. And by that, albeit there is no monetization of that piece, as soon as people are accustomed to Tencent's offerings, that is where they're able to tap into the real offers that are monetized by Tencent and WeChat. And that's where we see the real growth in terms of revenue.
We didn't see that in front of you. You made a very good comment of One Belt, One Road concept of China.
Yeah.
But then you just touched on Africa.
Yeah.
Why did you go to Africa? And you were very right. And can you put up that slide?
Sure.
That was very interesting.
Yes.
You went through that. And you went to Africa and you said very appropriately, the infrastructure is not there. You made 2 points. You said infrastructure is not there, therefore the cost of implementing it is large.
Okay.
But the One Belt, One Road goes through a lot of other regions, including Asia.
Mm-hmm.
So why didn't you choose Asia? Because infrastructure exists and that row would have looked very different. That's one. The second thing is, with Africa, you said one peso is a big this thing. Why didn't you think about Tencent just buying this thing? I mean, they have a huge cash surplus. Why didn't you look at just acquiring that in Africa to penetrate that market?
I think one most important reason why we select Africa over all of those other Asian countries that you mentioned was because just now, as you mentioned, like Chinese government, they are very supportive of WeChat, and then WeChat needs to operate in this supportive government where they do not, they're not very sensitive about competitors or censorship. And so we think that because Chinese government has a really friendly relationship with African government, most of the governments in Africa, so we think that also that when I was there, I saw a lot of Chinese workers doing infrastructure such as railway there, so we think that they will be supportive of our WeChat functions, and also that Uber as well as other food delivery systems are not very, very advanced in Africa, so we think that there's a very huge potential market out there. Regarding your second question, which is why Tencent shouldn't acquire the M-Pesa, it is because that I think M-Pesa doesn't really operate in line with our mission and statement with Tencent. So what M-Pesa is, so if you have two classmates and you want to send money to each other, they will just text each other, and then usually they can tap 5 cents or 10 cents. So like they have zero minimum requirement. However, for WeChat, due to security as well as transaction costs, we have this minimum requirement of $50 whenever you 50 RMB whenever you transfer money, especially from red packet or just online transfer. So I think that it does not really align with our mission. And then also like for Africans, they usually when they transfer, it's micro payment. So then I think that they will not use WeChat very often because they do not reach that minimum requirement.
Thank you.
Thank you very
much. Thank you so much.